devour, dog, anxious, senior, car, item, president, worried, avocado, Zendaya, licorice, nerdfighter, toothbrush, zany, expedient.
This isn't really a Vlogbrothers video. It's just a random string of words. There aren't any coherent sentences. It looks like John Greenbot could use some help speaking a bit more like human John Green. Sounds like an excellent task for natural language processing. Hey, I'm Jabril, and welcome to Crash Course AI. Today, we're going to tackle another hands-on lab. Our goal today is to get John Greenbot to produce language that sounds like human John Green, and have some fun while doing it. We'll be writing all of our code using a language called Python in a tool called Google Collaboratory. And as you watch this video, you can follow along with the code in your browser from the link we put in the description. In these collaboratory files, there's some regular text explaining what we're trying to do, and pieces of code that you can run by pushing the play button. Now, these pieces of code build on each other, so keep in mind that you have to run them in order from top to bottom, otherwise you might get an error. To actually run the code and experiment with changing it, you'll have to either click Open in Playground at the top of the page, or open the file menu and click Save a Copy to Drive. And just FYI, you'll need a Google account for this. Now, we're going to build an AI model that plays a clever game of fill in the blank. We'll be able to give John Greenbot any word prompt like good morning, and he'll be able to finish the sentence. Like any AI, John Greenbot really won't understand anything. But AI generally does a pretty good job of finding and copying patterns. When we teach any AI system to understand and produce language, we're really asking it to find and copy patterns in some behavior. So, to build a natural language processing AI, we need to do four things. First, gather and clean the data. Second, set up the model. Third, train the model. And fourth, make predictions. So, let's start with the first step, gather and clean the data. In this case, the data are lots of examples of human John Green talking, and thankfully, he's talked a lot online. We need some way to process his speech, and how can we do that? Subtitles. And conveniently, there's a whole database of subtitle files on the Nerdfighteria wiki that I pulled from. I went ahead and collected a bunch and put them in one big file that's hosted on Crash Course AI's GitHub. This first bit of code in 1.1 loads it. So, if you want to make your own AI sound like someone else, like Michael from Vsauce, or me, this is where you'd load all that text instead. Data gathering is often the hardest and slowest part of any machine learning project, but in this instance, it's pretty straightforward. Regardless, we still aren't done yet. Now, we need to clean up and prep our data for the model. This is called preprocessing. Remember, a computer can only process data as numbers, so we need to split our sentences into words, and then convert our words into numbers. When we're building a natural language processing program, the term word may not capture everything we need to know. How many instances there are of a word can also be useful. So instead, we'll use the terms lexical type and lexical token. Now, a lexical type is a word, and a lexical token is a specific instance of a word, including any repeats. So, for example, in the sentence, the goal of machine learning is to make a learning machine. We have 11 lexical tokens, but only 9 lexical types, because learning and machine both occur twice. In natural language processing, tokenization is the process of splitting a sentence into a list of lexical tokens. In English, we put spaces between words. So let's start by slicing up a sentence at the spaces. Good morning, Hank. It's Tuesday. We'll turn into a list like this, and we would have 5 tokens. However, there are a few problems. Something tells me we don't really want a lexical type for Hank, comma, and Tuesday period. So let's add some extra rules for punctuation. Thankfully, there are some pre-written libraries for this. Using one of those, the list would look something like this. In this case, we would have 8 tokens instead of 5. And tokenization even helps split up our contraction its into it and apostrophe s. Looking back at our code, before tokenization, we had over 31,000 lexical types. This code here at step 1.2 also splits our data into a training data set and a validation data set. We want to make sure the model learns from from the training data, but we also needed to test it on new data it's never seen before. That's what the validation dataset is for. We can count up our lexical types and lexical tokens with this bit of code in step 1.3. And it looks like we actually have about 23,000 unique lexical types. But remember, how many instances of a word can also be useful? This code block here at step 1.4 allows us to separate how many lexical types occur more than once, twice, and so on. It looks like we have a lot of rare words. Almost 10,000 words occur only once. Having rare words is really tricky for AI systems because they're trying to find and copy patterns. So they need lots of examples of how to use each word. Oh, human John Green, you master of prose. Let's see what weird words you use. Pisca? What even is a Lilliputian? Some of these are pretty tricky and are going to be hard for John Greenbot's AI to learn with just this dataset. But others seem doable if we take advantage of morphology. Morphology is the way a word gets shapeshifted to match a tense, like you'd add an ed to make something past tense, or when you shorten or combine words to make them totes amazeballs. Dear viewers, I did not write that in the script. In English, we can remove a lot of extra word endings, like ed, ing, or ly, through a process called stemming. And so, with a few simple rules, we can clean up our data even more. I'm also going to simplify the data by replacing numbers with hashtags, or pound signs, whatever you want to call it. This should take care of a lot of the rare words. Now we have 3,000 fewer lexical types, and about 8,000 words only occur once. We really need multiple examples of each word for our AI to learn patterns reliably. So we'll simplify it even more by replacing each of those 8,000 or so rare lexical tokens with the word UNK. Or unknown. Basically, we don't want John Greenbot to get embarrassed if he sees a word he doesn't know. So by applying the UNK token at 1.8 and hiding some words, we can teach John Greenbot how to keep writing when he bumps into one-time made-up words like zombie corns. And just to satisfy my curiosity, yeah, John Greenbot doesn't need words like whippersnapper or zombification? John, what's up with the fixation with zombies? Anyways, we'll be fine without them. Now that we finally have our data all cleaned up and put together, we're done with preprocessing and can move on to step 2, setting up the model for John Greenbot. There are a couple of key things that we need to do. First, we need to convert the sentences into lists of numbers. We want one word for every lexical type, so this code box at 2.1 will build a dictionary that assigns every word in our vocabulary a number. Second, unlike us, the model can read a bunch of words at the same time, and we want to take advantage of that to help John Greenbot learn quickly. So, we're going to split the data into pieces called batches. Here, we're telling the model to read 20 sequences, which have 35 words each, at the same time. Alright, now it's time to finally build our AI. We're going to program John Greenbot with a simple language model that takes in a few words and tries to complete the rest of the sentence. So, we'll need two key parts, an embedding matrix and a recurrent neural network, or RNN for short. Just like we discussed in the natural language processing video last week, this is an encoder-decoder framework. So let's take it apart. An embedding matrix is a big list of vectors, which is basically a big table of numbers where each row corresponds to a different word. These vector rows capture how related two words are. So if two words are used in similar ways, then the numbers in their vectors should be similar. But to start, we don't know anything about the words. So, we just assign every word a vector with random numbers. Remember, we replaced all the words with numbers in our training data. So now, when the system reads in a number, it just looks up that row in the table and uses the corresponding vector as input. Part 1 is done. Words become indices, which become vectors, and our embedding matrix is ready to use. Now, we need a model that can use those vectors intelligently. This is where the RNN comes in. We talked about the structure of a recurrent neural network in our last video too, but it's basically a model that slowly builds a hidden representation by incorporating one new word at a time. Depending on the task, the RNN will combine new knowledge in different ways. With John Greenbot, we're training our RNN with sequences of words from Vlogbrothers scripts. Ultimately, our AI is trying to build a good summary to make sure a sentence has some overall meaning, and it's keeping track of the last word to produce a sentence that sounds like English. The RNN's output after reading the final word so far from a sentence is what we'll use to predict the next word. And this is what we'll use to train John Greenbot's AI after we build it. All of this is wrapped up in code block 2.3. So part two is done. We've got our embedding matrix and we have our RNN. Now we're ready for step three. Train our model. Remember when we split the data into pieces called batches? And remember earlier in Crash Course AI when we used backpropagation to train neural networks? Well, we can put those together, iterate over our data set, and run backpropagation on each example to train the model's weights. So, in step 3.1, we're defining how to train our model. And in step 3.2, we're defining how to evaluate our model. And in step 3.3, we're actually creating our model, which means training and evaluating it. Over the span of one epoch of training this model, the network will loop over every batch of data, reading it in, building representations, predicting the next word, and then updating its guesses. This will train over 10 epochs, which might take a couple of minutes. We're printing two numbers with each epoch, which are the model's training and validation perplexities. As the model learns, it realizes there are fewer and fewer good choices for the next word. The perplexity is a measure of how well the model has narrowed down the choices. Okay, it looks like the model is done training and has a perplexity of about 45 on train and 72 on validation. But it started with perplexities in the hundreds. We can interpret perplexities as the average number of guesses the model makes before it predicts the right answer. After seeing the data once, the model needed over 300 guesses for the next word, but now it's narrowed it down to fewer than 50. That's a pretty good improvement, even though it's far from perfect. Time to see what the model can write. But to do that, we need one final ingredient. So far in Crash Course AI, we've talked a lot about the one best label or the one best prediction an AI can make. But this doesn't always make sense to solve certain problems. If you wrote stories by always having the characters do the next obvious thing, they'd be pretty boring. So step four is inference, the part of AI where the machine gets to make some choices, but we can still help it a little bit. Let's think about what the final layer of the RNN is actually doing. We talk about it like it's outputting a single label or prediction, but actually the network is producing a bunch of scores or probabilities. The most likely word has the highest probability. The next most likely word is the second highest probability, and so on. Because we get probabilities at each step, instead of taking the best one every time to produce one sentence, we could sample three words and start three new sentences. Each of those three sentences could then start three more new sentences, and then we have a branching diagram of possibilities. Inference is so important because what the model can produce and what we want aren't necessarily the same thing. What we want is a really good sentence, but the model can only tell us the score for one word at a time. Let's look at this branching diagram. Whenever we choose a word, we create a new branch and keep track of its score or probability. If we multiply each score through to the end of the branch, we see that the top branch made the best scoring choice, but a worse sentence overall. So, we're going to implement a basic sampler in our program. This will take a bunch of random paths so we can sort the results by the probability of the full sentence. And we can see which sentences are better overall. Also, when asking John Greenbot to generate all these sentences, we need to give him a word to start. I'm going to try good for now, but you can try other start words by changing the code in 4.1. Remember the preprocessing we did on our data? That's why these sentences look a little off. With hashtags for numbers and those spaces before the word endings that we introduced when stimming. And look at the sentence you get from taking the highest probability word each time. Good morning, Hank. It's Tuesday. I'm going to see, it's not as interesting as the ones where we mixed it up a bit and took different branches. To be honest though, none of these are great Vlogbrothers scripts. That's because of two important things. First, there's our data. Remember, we didn't have many examples of how to use each word. In fact, we had to cut out a lot of rare words during training because they only showed up once. So we couldn't teach John Greenbot to recognize any patterns related to them. Lots of state-of-the-art models address this by downloading data from Wikipedia, large collections of books, or even Reddit when they train their models. We'll include some links in the description if you want to play with some fancier models. But the second, bigger issue is that AI models are missing the understanding we have as humans. sentence. Even if John Greenbot split up words perfectly and predicted sentences that sounded like English, it's still John Greenbot using tools like tokenization, an embedding matrix, and a simple language model to predict the next word. When human John Green writes, he uses his understanding of the world. Like in Vlogbrothers videos, he considers Hank's perspective or whoever's watching. He's not just trying to predict which next word has the highest probability. Building models to interact with people and the world is why natural language processing is so exciting. But it's also why it'll take a lot more work to get John Greenbot to generate language as well as human John Green does. We left a bunch of notes in the code for you to play with if you want to make your own AI. You can train it for longer, change the sentence prompt, or if you're feeling adventurous, replace the text data to speak in someone else's voice. If you end up using this to make something cool, let us know in the comments. Thanks for watching, see you next week. PBS Digital Studios wants to hear from you. We do a survey every year that asks what you're into, your favorite PBS shows, and things you like to see more from PBS Digital Studios. You even get to vote on potential new shows. All of this helps us make more stuff that you want to see. The survey takes about 10 minutes, and you might win a sweet t-shirt. Link is in the description. Thanks. Crash Course AI is produced in association with PBS Digital Studios. If you want to help keep Crash Course free for everyone forever, you can join our community on Patreon. And if you want to learn more about NLP, check out this video from Crash Course Computer Science.